Welcome to Time Audio. Enjoy. Acquittal, the goal of every criminal defense. Unfortunately, if you are representing a defendant on appeal, the goal was not met. If trial counsel made a motion for judgment of acquittal which was denied, you can appeal that decision. However, the Court of Appeals reviews entire record and accompanying references in light most favorable to the government. Under this deferential standard, the Court of Appeals will only reverse if there is no evidence from which any rational trier of fact could have found the essential elements of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt. A motion of acquittal made at the close of the government's case must be renewed or it will be waived. Proving that no evidence exists from which any rational trier of fact could have found the essential elements of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt presents a nearly insurmountable hurdle to the defendant. The Court of Appeals will reverse only if the record is devoid of evidence from which a jury could find guilt. Anders motion and brief. A criminal defense attorney must file a notice of appeal at the client's request. As an officer of the court, however, appellate counsel has a duty not to present frivolous arguments. If, after reviewing the entire record on appeal, defense counsel determines there are no non-frivolous issues to be presented in the appeal, defense counsel must file a motion to withdraw, and a brief explaining the possible issues that could be raised and why those issues are frivolous. The Supreme Court case outlining this procedure is Anders v. California, 3.8.6 U.S. 7.3.8. 1967, thus the term Anders brief. An Anders motion can be made and granted when there is a ground for appeal that is not barred by dispositive case law, clear statutory language, or any other clear legal bar to the ground, but instead involves the application of law to fact. A frivolous appeal is one that is groundless, and frivolous arguments are merely arguments that cannot conceivably persuade the court. In an Anders brief, counsel must detail anything in the record that might support an argument on appeal. If appellate court finds that appeal is frivolous, it may grant counsel's motion to withdraw. If Anders brief is inadequate on its face, counsel's motion to withdraw will be denied, and the appellate court will either direct counsel to file a new brief or discharge counsel and appoint a new lawyer for defendant. If Anders brief is adequate on its face, appellate court will limit its review of records to issues discussed in brief. If the Anders brief explains the nature of the case and fully and intelligently discusses the issues that the type of case might be expected to involve, the Court of Appeals will not conduct an independent top-to-bottom review of the record. The Court of Appeals gives broad discretion to attorneys to decide what matters to discuss in an Anders brief, however, the degree to which it relies on counsel to determine whether an appeal is warranted requires sufficient indicia in the brief that counsel has made a sound judgment. Appeal. It is crucial for defense counsel to timely file the notice of appeal. If trial counsel has failed to timely file a notice of appeal when requested to do so by the defendant, appellate counsel must argue either excusable neglect or that the defendant was abandoned by trial counsel. Under Federal Rules of Appellate Procedure 4B, 3BI, a notice of appeal filed prior to a ruling on a motion to reconsider in the district court becomes effective upon the district court's entry of judgment on that motion to reconsider. Time for appeal may not be extended absent showing of excusable neglect. The requirement of excusable neglect is jurisdictional. An experienced federal criminal litigator's failure to file a timely notice of appeal was not excusable neglect under FRAP 4B, even though the attorney relied on FRCP 45A, which allows exclusion of Saturday, Sunday, and legal holidays in determining the time of filing when the deadline is 10 days or less. Rule 45A of the criminal rules governs procedure in the district courts, not in the Court of Appeals. Trial judges must be meticulous and precise in following each of the requirements of Rule 32C, 5, requiring that a defendant be advised of his right to appeal. Failure to give such advice is error. Although a court's failure to advise a defendant of his right to appeal is error, a defendant is entitled to collateral relief only when the defendant is actually prejudiced by the court's error. A petitioner is not prejudiced by a court's failure to advise him of right to appeal where the record establishes that he had actual notice of his right to appeal. Perfunctory and undeveloped arguments are waived on appeal. Appeal by the government. The government's failure to file a certificate that the appeal is not taken for the purpose of delay and that the evidence is a substantial proof of a fact material in the proceeding is not necessarily fatal to the appeal. If the government files the certificate late, the appellate court has discretion in deciding whether to hear the appeal in light of such defect. Failure of government to file notice of appeal within 30 days of the district court's opinion divests jurisdiction from Court of Appeals. Batson v. Kentucky challenges, the prosecution cannot use a peremptory challenge to remove a potential juror from the jury pool based on the juror's race or sex. It is the juror's right to sit as a juror, not the defendant's right to have minorities on the jury, which is being protected. Accordingly, the race or sex of the defendant is irrelevant for purposes of a Batson challenge. Once challenged, the prosecutor must put forth a race-neutral or sex-neutral reason for striking the juror. Review of ruling on motivation for strike of potential juror from panel, clearly erroneous. A Batson hearing normally progresses through three stages. 1. The defendant must make a prima facie showing that the prosecutor has exercised peremptory challenges on the basis of race. 2. Once that showing has been made, the burden shifts to the prosecutor to articulate a race-neutral explanation for striking the jurors in question. And, 3. The trial court, after hearing the defendant's response, must decide whether those reasons are pretextual and whether the defendant has thus carried his burden of proving purposeful discrimination. Whether a prima facie case has been shown presents a mixed question of law and fact and is reviewed de novo. Where a prosecutor excused each and every African-American member of the jury veneer, such a pattern was sufficient as a matter of law to make a prima facie showing that the preceptor exercised the peremptory challenges on the basis of race. Although silly or superstitious reasons for peremptory challenges are constitutionally legitimate, the weaker the reason for the peremptory challenge, the more likely it is to be a pretext for discrimination. Bill of Particulars. A bill of particulars sets forth the charges against a defendant in more detail than is contained in the indictment. The prosecution can be ordered to file a bill of particulars when the information contained in the indictment is not sufficiently detailed to enable the defendant to prepare for trial. Review of ruling on whether to grant or deny a motion for bill of particulars. Abuse of discretion. Test for necessity for bill of particulars. Letter of indictment sets forth elements of offense charged and sufficiently apprises defendant of charges to enable him to prepare for trial. Bill of particulars unnecessary where nature and operation of open file policy by government provided satisfactory form of retrievable information. For the Court of Appeals to reverse a decision to deny a bill of particulars, the defendant must suffer actual prejudice from the denial.